All right. Pushing since day one. Pushing since day one. Got that shirt, this shirt today. Yeah. And you might be thinking, when is this guy ever going to stop pushing? Sometimes I ask myself that, why am I even trying? Well, the more I try, the clearer it gets for me. And we need greater and greater clarity because we are, everyone's failing, okay? No doubt about it. But how do you turn failure around? This is the question. We have to realize that we're addicted to excuses. And without failure, we don't have excuses to fail. So that's a real clever catch-22. We have the continuity fear bothering us, and people casting their fate upon luck. They're all just saying, maybe I'll get lucky. There's no luck involved at all. And so everyone is stuck. They're severely stuck in this world, very badly stuck. Okay, so you say, okay, we're stuck. You start there. I thought this was the information age sharing. I've spent my life trying to produce audio visual material, spiritual material that can be shared globally over the technology. It just isn't happening at all. But I have to say that this YouTube channel here is actually a big success. If you compare it with the other stuff in the world, almost nothing has any traction. At least we get like 50 views or so, sometimes more, on these videos, where most spiritual content in the world gets nothing. Gets nothing. It can be very depressing if you see all the efforts that have been made, and the people simply we're lacking discipline, plain and simple. Lacking discipline. Just because there's all this junk out there doesn't mean you watch it. You simply don't watch it. I just don't watch it. You have to, and what I suggest is you got to take a because we're so stuck, you have to take some pretty strict measures and just boycott stuff. Say, oh, I'm boycotting that. That means I don't look at it at all. I'm boycotting movies. Just a movie? Okay, I don't watch it. Plain and simple. I don't think, well, do I watch this movie or not? Maybe I should watch. You simplify. You have to simplify. You just boycott it. I boycott television. I don't watch any television. It's not a question of what's on. People say, well, yeah, but this is golf. That's not so bad. No, complete boycott. Very simple. That means 99.9999% of the stuff that I'm boycotting, absolutely, I should be boycotting it. And the tiny fraction that might be, well, it might be okay. You know what? It doesn't want you to watch it either because that will lure you into the other 99%, and the commercials will hit you. It's all designed to generate forgetfulness of our true nature, this whole scenario in the world now. So you have to simplify, just absolutely simplify, simplify, simplify. So, what can I say positive today? A lot of positives today, even though I also went through sort of a depressed episode of just, I'm not getting anywhere. I've worked 24/7 my whole life, and it's just, it's unbelievable, isn't it? And to me, it's just so unbelievable. I just have to keep studying and say, what in the world is going on with people? Are they really? They're so messed up. So how can we turn it around? This is how can we turn it around? There's a way to turn it around, and we just have to catch wind of that. The discipline has to be you just pay attention to the gurus, the Dharma kings, the saviors, the saints, and bodhisattvas, the gurus. You just spend your time paying attention to them. That's it. That's all I've done my whole life, basically. And it's necessary. We're so messed up, it's necessary. How do you get rid of good habits? You just start good ones. I mean, how do you get rid of bad habits? You just start good ones. You don't struggle with the bad habits, okay? That doesn't work. Just start good habits. Good habits is on your smartphone, just pictures of Ram Maharshi. I put up all these picture collections on the internet. Nobody accesses them. I could get like zero, views. I put up 1,000 pictures, and zero views, or one or two views in years. I say, How is that possible? Aren't people looking searching for like Ram Maharshi pictures, and they can on their smartphone they can download the pictures and then put together their own slideshow? Is that really too much? Like, am I, isn't that a great way to spend your time? Nobody's doing it. If you're doing it, you're like one of the very few people in the world that are doing anything like this. And so the fact that so few are doing it scares everybody. Okay, so everybody's been scared away from it, simply thinking, uh-oh, I'm missing the mainstream of quote-unquote evolution. No, you're missing the mainstream of the lemmings going off the cliff, is what you're doing here. You're not going off the cliff. So today, I got on my skateboard for the first time. Got on my skateboard. Where is my? Let's bring the skateboard out. Here it is. Got on the skateboard for the first time. Yeah. And haven't really skated for 45 years. Whoops. Already something fell down there. Oh my gosh. So it just shows you they're tricky. Stuff's falling all over the place here. So falling is part of the problem, of course. And getting things set up properly is important. And I'm not set up properly here with all this stuff I've got. I've got too much stuff here. And so I'm just, on the fly here. See, part of the thing in a spiritual path, people don't, they just, we don't get it. Okay, and again, we've lost our confidence. You just have to do stuff like that. Yeah, the idea is like, well, I'm on camera, I can't do that, is ridiculous. The idea, well, I'm in this world, which is like being on camera, and I can't do spiritual stuff, is ludicrous. Of course you can. Yeah, but nobody else is doing it. Well, they're going over the cliff of transmigration, and they're going to suffer terrible misery because of it. That's not very cool. So they're being uncool. So if the mainstream is being extremely uncool and crass, which they are, why go along with that? You don't have to, just be disciplined. And yet, it's not happening. So we're just patiently looking at this, and the answers are emerging. Anyway, so I went skateboarding today. And what I did was I just rolled down a very gentle slope, super gentle slope. I also got a wrench to tighten up the trucks, which were too loose, in my opinion. It was like almost like too much turning, too easy to turn. So I tightened them up, and then I got some T-shirts. The T-shirts were on sale. I got a bunch of T-shirts. I haven't bought T-shirts in such a long time. When I was younger, I just wore T-shirts because a lot of kids, of course, we just wear T-shirts. I love T-shirts, and I'm going back to T-shirts. So, here's something that may help us all. Those who are struggling, to keep going, feeling that they're more and more and more being marginalized. This is the trouble, isn't it? More and more and more, we have to keep a lower profile and do it, but do it consciously. Understand what we're doing it for. We're protecting our momentum here. So instead of like appearing to be some big guru, is here we do the opposite. I'm just a little skateboard boy, a little skateboarder from California kind of thing. And we have this little skateboard cult. People bring their skateboards to, for a talk, and we all, dress up in t-shirts or something. Like, people are like, pfft, that's ridiculous. So the ego is expecting all these, spiritual types. It says, yeah, you got to be like that. It's the ego focuses on the structure, the superficial, the form, the format, the structure, the concepts, everything, marketing. So they're marketing spiritual materialism. So we need to avoid spiritual materialism at all cost. You have to avoid that at all costs, the Holy Spirit is telling us. So the Holy Spirit said, you need to adopt this different persona. I have a different persona. I'm not, the guru persona. I'm an assistant. I'm an assistant teacher, a student teacher under the supervision of Longchenpa. Okay, that's what I am. Dharma Prince. It's a student teacher. Just imagine like a PhD, and they have their graduate students. They take graduate students, do a lot of work for the professor. Okay, that's what I do. I do work for Longchenpa, and he has the entire welfare of all in mind perfectly, and all Dharma kings do. So I don't have any favorites with Dharma kings. I love them all equally. I don't have favorites. It's just I've been assigned to Longchenpa because he's all business. He I like the Bodhisattva ideal. There's a lot. I just fit in nicely there. Okay, but I would be equally thrilled to work under any of the Dharma kings. I feel, again, I don't have any favorites. Sri Sri Nandamai Ma, Ram Maharshi, Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Jamyang Gyentse Choki Lodro, Padmasambhava. I'd be thrilled. I'd be thrilled at any time to be a student teacher, assistant under any of them. And you work for one, you're working for all of them anyway. Okay, that's a fact. That's a fact. So I'm spending a lot of time on Ram Maharshi, a slideshow tonight, trying to get it going. See, I want to promote the legacy of all. My whole life, I've been promoting the legacy of all traditions, all saints. It's just promote the legacy, promote the legacy, and to see it just disappear like, water in a desert, has just been devastating for me. Because that's my whole life is to grow the legacy of all this, and it, instead of growing, it shrunk to the point of extinction. So it is like, wow. And of course, what we're looking at is the collapse of civilization coming up, collapse of culture. And I've been basically advised that, my role is to help reconstitute culture at some point, either here or some other realm. I don't know if it's going to be on this planet or someplace else. There's a lot of people, the silent majority in this world, want to get down to business, spiritual business. They want an austere, disciplined, challenging culture, spiritually challenging culture. They really want to get, that's the silent majority. Where we've been invaded in this world by a bunch of clever, gimmicky folks that have, just like the Native American Indians were invaded by some clever, gimmicky folks. And they said, here, look at these glass beads. And we've gotten mesmerized by their glass beads. And said, hey, oh yeah, I really want those beads. My wife really wants them. So what do you want? Well, just your land. Our land? Well, we don't own any land, but you want it? You want this land? Oh, sure, fine. Yeah, you can have hunt here too. Okay, well, here's a piece of paper. Just sign it. Sign it. I don't know how to sign it. Well, just put your thumbprint or something. Okay, good. Oh, we have a legal document. You've turned this land over to us. We own it now. It's like that. This is what's happened again. This colonialism comes in. This is cosmic colonialism, which is happening in the world right now. Cosmic colonialism. Nothing short of that. Okay, we've been invaded. This planet's been invaded by these tech people from different realm. I'm aware of the realm they're coming from, and they just take birth here in this world, and they set up their shops. Hey, look at these, look at this little, glass bead here. Look at this little smartphone here. You'd be mesmerized by it. Be mesmerized by it. And we forget our discipline. We forget our purpose. We forget the gurus. We forget our legacy, and we sell our legacy down the drain. For pornography, for action videos, for violent videos, for stupid cartoons and stuff. We flush our legacy here down the toilet. This is the stupidest thing ever. Okay, what we're doing is the stupidest thing ever done. And yet we know it is stupid, and we can't seem to stop doing it. Isn't that amazing? So the first thing you do is recognize it and laugh at it. Just say, "Wow, yeah, that's pretty funny, isn't it?" And have a sense of humor about it. This is better than being all angry and upset. It helps to, it brings in energy. It brings in confidence when you laugh. Okay, we should do laughing yoga. Actually, maybe I will. Let's do laughing skateboard yoga. Okay. Yeah. And we should sing more. Just sing and ooh. I'm like singing background to the Beach Boys now. And this is like a student teacher. They're like in the band. I'm in the band, but I'm singing background. Well, that's great. I love singing background. That's fine. It pumps up the whole song. And occasionally, then you sing chorus also. That's great. Extend the legacy of the Dharma Kings, the ones that really know what they're doing. Let them be the center of attention. You help them. It's like, you do a lot of work, they get the credit. Good, because they're the ones who should be the figurehead of the legacy, okay? Because they know what it's all about. Totally. So this is my perspective. Build, grow the legacy of the Dharma Kings like Ram Maharshi. I try to grow that legacy. I try to grow it. I've done so much in that regard for Ram Maharshi, so much for Sri Sri Anandamayi. Nobody knows how much I've done because I don't say what I've done. I was told just keep yourself anonymous about what you're doing. So, okay, but I've done a massive amount. So to some extent, I've helped there with the internet and all of that availability of a lot of stuff. And then, of course, I've done a massive amount for Jesus Christ. I've done a tremendous amount for Longchenpa, some for Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodo, and less for Padmasambhava. But the Nyingma Masters are sort of one conglomerate there. So I've done a lot for that too. So, but it's watering, in the desert. It's just amazing. So the skateboard went fine. And I was like, wow. And I'm just going, whoa. It's like you got to get used to it. You got to go slow, very slow. So I bought the clothes. I'm doing stuff. The Holy Spirit says, lay low. You got to sink into the background now. And we have to just later on, as Ram Maharshi told me about the year 2000, I said, Ramana, everything I'm doing, I'm pushing so hard. Nothing's working. He says, yeah, I know. He says, but don't worry. What you're doing will bear fruit down the road. It'll bear tremendous fruit, he says. So just don't give up. Well, down the road, he might mean, 100 years from now, 200, 300, he probably wasn't talking about this lifetime. It hasn't happened this lifetime. I'm hitting 60 soon. And it's just like I've done nothing. Yeah, it's pretty tough to take. Because it's a time when people are so distracted you can't do anything to help them. Not really. But certainly we need those who help reconstitute culture once it collapses and it goes down the drain, which will be quite soon, actually. And then the people who really, say, hey, we really didn't want this stuff. We were just so mesmerized by it. But now we want to get down to business. We're going to need a lot of bodhisattvas, a lot of, the Dharma Kings, the bodhisattvas, enlightenment gurus, assistant teachers. We're going to need a lot of those to reconstitute society. Religion has to have authority over culture. There's no question about it. I've studied the entire thing. My whole life, I've put in a massive effort to study what's wrong, what works, what's the answer. And the answer is, religion has to have authority over culture. There's no question about it. Has to have authority over nature. Okay, and so the bottom line is religion has been right throughout history, and put it mildly, feminism is wrong, plain and simple. Okay, and I've studied this objectively, fairly, to the ultimate extent, and I understand what it's all about. So I agree with the Dharma Kings. That's why I can work with them because we're not fighting. I understand. You're right. We're right and humanism is wrong. Okay? Humanism comes from nature. Feminism comes from nature. All this nature is an attempt to delude ourselves, to defamiliarize ourselves with what we really are. You cannot let nature lead or even have any equal standing whatsoever because our continuity fear means we default back to trusting in nature. Trusting in the ego, okay? Because we're so addicted to thinking that we need excuses, that means we need the ego, we need failure, We think that we don't have failure, don't have excuses. We're not what not our true nature. This is totally wrong. So we're in this terrible double bind and fear, and that to give equal standing to nature and religion and transcending nature is total delusion. If the goal is to transcend nature, you can't then put nature on equal standing. Jesus did not have a dual nature at all. That's totally mistaken. He had a divine nature and only a divine nature. Okay. And that's our nature too, is only divine actually. We don't have a nature coming from, we don't have an identity coming from nature. Okay. Biophysical, you know, biochemical, you know, all this nature. We don't have any nature at all, identity coming from that whatsoever. None. Zero. You can't give an equal standing to truth and lies. It's ridiculous. So the answer is truth has to dominate lies. Okay. In order for anybody to gain, really make progress. What's happened is we have simply been making faux progress, spinning our wheels and claiming we've been making progress. Most of us, that's all we've been doing for many lifetimes. It's true. And we have to be able to keep laughing at this, which is very helpful. If there's somebody who can actually see this and laugh at it, that's extremely helpful for us. Otherwise, it's too difficult to see. It really is very depressing. It can be very depressing if you actually, when you see it, you know, I'm seeing things so clearly. It's like, oh my gosh, it's like, wow. You can't do it that way. So we have to be way, way, way more strict, and there's simply no two ways about it. Now, nature, what we call nature, is the production of bodies, okay? That's what it is. And, of course, females are the ones that produce the new bodies to replace the ones that are dying, okay? So in nature, nature is female-based. It's feminine-based, you know, to an extreme extent. And it favors the feminine female to an enormous extent. Males are very expendable, very expendable. A woman has 30 eggs. If she dies, all 30 eggs die with her. If the man dies and the woman lives, there's still 30 eggs, and another man can come along and fertilize all those eggs. A thousand men can die, and still there's the 30 eggs are still there. And all it takes is one man to fertilize those, you know, 30 eggs, and so one male. So it totally favors women, females, nature, totally. So females have a massive leverage over men in nature. Okay, that's how nature is constructed. It has to be that way. All right, so we're not saying, well, that's stupid. But no, that's the way it has to be. If you're in the business of reproducing bodies, if you're in the business of death, which is what nature is in, the business of death, that has to be that way. Okay, so if you are freeing yourself from nature, you cannot give it, if you're not giving equal standing of nature, because in nature, females dominate. They absolutely do. When you go back to a nature humanism, females absolutely dominate. They enslave men. Men are just drones. This is well known. So you cannot allow females to be on the same level in religion. You cannot give them the high standing. This throughout history, they have not had the high standing, because they will dominate. Because you're allowing them then to put them on nature on equal level, and they will use that leverage over men, crush the whole thing. That's why Jesus chose 12 male disciples. Throughout history, religions have used men, because men don't have the leverage. They're not used to having leverage in nature. So they have to become experts at what they're doing to have any standing whatsoever. Wait, but they don't have to do anything in nature just to have natural leverage over men. They can be ignorant of it, uneducated. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all. So for a man to feel any sort of accomplishment, he really has to study and learn, and he has to just become more and more expert, and more and more expert, and expert, expert, expert. And you cannot use nature at all, you see, in religion. Religion transcends nature entirely. It tells that nature is a lie. It is absolutely a lie. So again, you cannot try to put nature on the same level as religion. This is a disaster, and this is what has happened in the world. And it's caused a virtual complete collapse of religion in the world. So this is a lesson learned. So women have to take tremendous efforts to not exploit their advantage over men. And when they do that, guess what? Men start learning the truth and sharing it with women, sharing it with the world. And everybody benefits. Whereas if women exploit their advantage over men, what happens? You get materialism. Secular, humanistic materialism. And then society collapses into, you know, in a hideous ways, which is what is going to happen here in this world. We've made the same mistake, you know, the worst mistake you can possibly make. Because what happened was, you got this corruption of the world, this attempt to subvert this world by going and telling women, hey, listen, you know, men have been suppressing you throughout history. They've been holding you back. They wouldn't let you develop your full potential to get what you really want. Women have been suppressing them, holding back, refusing to use their leverage over men to enslave them so that we would get this blossoming of religion, of truth in the world. If women don't discipline themselves, you don't get any, very little blossoming of truth in the world, which is what's happened now. So religion is really a success story coming from women in large extent, actually. And so when religion collapses, which is collapsing now, that's a failure on the part of women in the world, severe failure on their part. And men, the problem in the world right now, you might say, is there aren't any men that can stand up to women at all anymore in the world. You know, I'm like one of extreme rarities now, super, super rare. They can't do it. They simply can't. Because women said, no, we don't want you doing that. We want, you've been suppressing us, repressing us. It's your fault. We could have had all this material abundance all along, you know, and you've kept us from this. How terrible, you know. No, that's just what's going to happen is hideous, what's going to happen here in the world. We've been avoiding that throughout history. Avoiding a, you know, tremendous collapse because women were willing to discipline themselves and not exploit their leverage over men so much. They said, hey, wait a minute, you know, I could really enslave him, but no, that's a sin. Okay, that's my essential sin, is my tendency, my using the leverage over men to exploit them. I won't do that. Modesty, you know, the whole thing that women have to discipline themselves, that's essential. That is essential. If that doesn't happen, religion cannot thrive in this world. Cannot. Doesn't matter how expert the men are, the culture will not listen. That turns towards materialism. This is what happens. So I've seen this firsthand. I had a front row seat to the whole thing, so I've learned these lessons. So, you know, when we reconstitute culture, it's going to be reconstituted in the right way. And women have to take great pains and efforts to not exploit their advantage over men. And they have done that in the past. So it's not like they can't do it. They have the capability to do it. They have so much energy and so much capacity and multitasking capacity. They can do it. They absolutely can do it. They're just choosing not to right now. And that, you know, they just turn into pigs, basically, you know. There's no other way to put it. It's just disgusting. Modern women are absolutely disgusting, actually. Most of them. There's some rare exceptions. You know, you see a rare exception, it's like, wow, women could be like this. Wow. Yeah. And, you know, how much we appreciate the women who do discipline themselves and don't exploit their advantage over men, how much we appreciate that immensely, immensely. Appreciate that. It's essential. It's like nobody can breathe otherwise. We have this materialism being shoved down our throats. We can't even spiritually breathe at all. Like I said, the modern women are just pigs. That's all there is. That's all there is to it. And, you know, robotic pigs, they just let themselves go. They just let themselves go. And how ugly that is. It's so ugly. You know, what can I get out of my drone to get me more material things? You know, more comforts, more conveniences, more ambition, more this, 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 that. How stupid that is, isn't it? How totally stupid that is. And it's just history repeating themselves. Again, in Native American Indians, the reason why they're able to sell all those fancy Venetian beads and mirrors and all these vanity stuff is because the squaws demanded it of, you know. Yeah. They said, wow, if I put this stuff in my hair and necklace and stuff, I look so beautiful. Look at the mirror. Oh my gosh. You know, vanity. Female vanity is a destroyer of civilization, plain and simple. And women know that, and they should know that. That should be the first thing they're taught. Is vanity, for me, is the greatest sin of all. Okay, it's the most ruinous, it's a ruinous sin in nature, because that's how nature works. You can't give free rein to nature here, everyone. Hear this very clearly. You cannot give free rein to nature. You must discipline yourself and say no to nature, plain and simple. And it's easy to do. Once you just decide it, it's easy to do. That's saying the first thing the devil did to subvert the world is teach women makeup. Give them mirrors and makeup. Right? Always the subverters, the saboteurs that come to this planet, they always target the women. Always. And they target their vanity. Always. Because they know that's how to collapse religious discipline in this world. And it's collapsed. It's collapsed. In spite of my best efforts to try to find some way, you know, I tried all sorts of stuff. It doesn't work without the, they're going to have to learn the hard way, unfortunately. Which is crazy, because the great efforts that we put in throughout history here, to throw that all away, you know, is just tremendous folly. But it we'll have to reconstitute it and you know, the rules will have to be, you know, very, the rules have been strict throughout history. I don't know how to make them any stricter. It's up to each one of us, you know, whether we're going to discipline ourselves or not. You can't force discipline on people. It doesn't really work. They just become like kind of just robots in terms of, yeah, going along with this. But in their hearts, you know, they're easily subverted. This is the problem. So many people were conquered by religious armies and then converted, and they went along with the modesty thing. The women went along with it because they thought it would give them some benefit. But eventually they said, hey, wait a minute, you know, and vanity started reasserting itself. And then the competition started rising. Hey, she has, you know, this nice dress, and she goes to her husband and says, hey, look, you know, I mean, what's the matter with you? I mean, you want me to look like, you know, junky, like, and I don't feel comfortable like that. You know, I need a nice dress too. And then the man then starts competing more to get, you know, more money, and, you know, gradually materialism, all this stuff enters in. The truth is that it's way, way better to have a ragged success than an elegant failure. Okay, this has to be at the center of the new culture that will emerge eventually after the collapse of this culture. It could be devastation, actually. But it wouldn't be the slightest bit surprising if it was severe devastation. So the key is, it's vastly superior to have a ragged success than an elegant failure. What the world is after is an elegant failure. Plain and simple. Elegant failures. Graceful failures. Clever failures. Glamorous failures. All this. And they mock the ragged success. For me, I'm a ragged success. I call this song Ragged But I'm Right. Great song by George Jones. Look it up. Ragged But Right. I'm ragged but I'm right. Something like that. I come here to tell you folks, I'm ragged but I'm right. And this is why what we're doing now is the skateboard sort of thing, you know, t-shirts, and, you know, the skateboard is for poor people, right? Yeah. You don't see rich people skateboard, do you? It's the kids. and the people that dispossess kids that don't, they can't afford cars, they skateboard to work, or they, you know, they base on bicycle. But it's for those who are on the fringes, you know. It's a fringe cultural thing, and the Holy Spirit says you got to now embrace the fringes, because you're very much fringe in this world, and you're not going to be able to go mainstream. That is true. So embrace the sidewalk culture. This is very serious. I went out and got the shirts today, the t-shirts, and I'm going to be wearing them. Skateboard t-shirts. Wow. Ragged but right. So I'm a great success story, really, spiritual success story. When anyone is asked to help out a Dharma King and be like a graduate student and do student teaching for a Dharma King, that's an extreme success. You know, but the world sees it as extreme failure, because they're saying, well, yeah, but you didn't make it to the top. Look, we have the top failure here. We have this top elegant failure. You know, we're way higher than you are, because we're elegant in our failure. You're just ragged in your success. So they're measuring it from the ego standpoint. You know, this is crazy, isn't it? It's insanity. I'm a success, but to the eyes of the ego, well, yeah, but it's ragged. It's not mainstream, you know. And you know, you struggled and you're still struggling, and you know that's not elegant. You need, you know, elegance is what's important. Failure, success doesn't matter. The ego is just, as long as you're elegant. And of course, failure is all the ego knows. So elegant failure, yeah, that's where it's at. So I tried to be an elegant success, but you know, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. Because how could you be an elegant success in this world spiritually right now? You can't. I don't care who it is. I could walk on water and raise the dead, and it would still be completely ragged to the egoic consciousness, the materialistic consciousness of the world. They say, well, the women don't think you're anything. Well, yeah, because they're caught up, they're entranced by vanity, and they've lost their discipline. You know, they're pigs. So yeah, pigs don't recognize, you know, diamonds. You know, is that the diamond's fault? I don't think so, is it? So it's always going to seem ragged now. So why even bother to fight that fight? It's not a fight that's worth fighting. This is what the Holy Spirit is showing me. And so it's better to take the humble path. The ragged, humble path is the best path. And embrace, you know, the fringe cultural aspect of it. Embrace it. You realize, yeah, we're on the fringe and we're proud of it. You know, that kind of attitude. The ego will just laugh at us. Ah, silly idiots. You know, they don't know what they're doing. They're so out of it, they have no idea. Yeah, well, guess who's going to be at the center of it when culture is reconstituted? Yeah, the fringe now will be the mainstream later. Okay. And we'll set up the new religion, the new institutions, the new way of doing things that get to actually help everyone towards success, genuine success. And again, like I said, the idea of women wanting, you know, positions, all they care about now seems to be they want to have positions of authority in religion. Just turn it over to us and we'll get it right, that kind of thing. No, you won't. Women have done tremendous work in disciplining themselves throughout history. That actually is the engine that drives the whole thing. And basically, they're just like, killing their engines. You know, and so the whole thing's collapsed. It's like, yeah, men are driving the car, but it's the women are the engine of the car. And so now the woman says, no, I want to drive. Well, guess what? The car's stalled out and it's going nowhere. It's going nowhere. So this whole sabotage, feminism was a sabotage of this world. It absolutely was. We all saw it. We all saw it happen. We say, well, come on, women can't be that stupid. They're not going to go for this. Well, you know what? All the bells and whistles that came along with it, hey. You know? So the whole, one of the purposes of religion throughout history is to keep those bells and whistles out of this world, because they knew it would subvert women and then the whole car would stall out. And this is what's happened. All the finery, you know, that's come into the world, all the textiles, the clothing, the gadgets, the conveniences, all this, so much stuff, right? The whole appearance thing. Vanity, the whole bundle of vanity. Once that gets into a world, you know, the world's cooked. It's cooked. You see a woman that has not allowed vanity to conquer her, and it's totally obvious. Totally obvious. Right away, you feel the vibe instantly. And then you realize that you can actually drive, you know. The engine is there to drive clarity, right? And profess clarity. You just feel it right away. But it's super rare now to come across that. Usually it's the older women. An older, like older Indian woman, you know, from India. She's not trying to interfere, to dominate and enslave the man, right? She realized, got the wisdom to say, hey, wait a minute. If I do that, I'm going to lose the clarity because I'm naturally multitask so much and have to deal with so much stuff that I need some help, right? I mean, the idea is that women, men need help and women need help. You need help to transcend nature, this delusion, to wake up from this dream. And if you don't get that help, you're not going to wake up. So women, smart, wise women realize, hey, you know what? Men can be quite helpful. So let's get the help that they can give us. Otherwise, we're not going to, you know, we're not going to stop transmigrating at all. It's a fact. So they're quiet. They're good. You know, they know they're dominating in most areas, but they say, let me not dominate in this area because actually men are pretty doggone good at doing this, you know. So let's listen to them. They can really give this adamant feel to it, you know. And the gurus, you know, let's listen to the gurus. This is what helps. But most women now are so stupid that they can't even do that at all. And then the men are terrified. You're like, oh gosh, you know, I can't stand up to that. Can't stand up. Can't stand up. Men have a terribly difficult time throughout history standing up to women. And, you know, a lot of times they overdid it because they're so frightened of the repercussions. They said, man, I got to crush women because if I stand up to them the right way, you know, they might get real angry and then crush me, that kind of thing. So it's been very ragged. You know, it's been very ragged. But it works. It works very well. Works very well. And that's a hard-fought culture. To have a balance in men and women like this, it's an extreme accomplishment for us in history. And now we've thrown that all away. We've thrown the jewel. We threw it away for some glass beads. You know, that's incredibly stupid. Women should get up every morning and say, what is my goal today? Is to suppress my vanity, suppress the effect that vanity has upon me. That terrible snake, that hideous snake that will bring us all down, bring us all down. So my role, my supremely important role is to suppress the effect of vanity upon me, upon my children, upon my husband, upon my family, my relatives, suppress that and give some space to listen to what the wise men have to say. And I'll tell you what, that just doesn't happen anymore. Everywhere I go, I don't find any forum for myself to speak at all. And socially, I can do it right here because there's nobody, no people around, nothing to stop me. I'm doing it late at night here. But if you go socially anywhere, In my whole life, I've never had hardly an instance where I've been invited to speak when people have said, you know what, I'm in the mood to really listen to something that a wise man might have to say, why someone wise might have to say. I want to hear it coming from you, the man. I want to encourage you, the man, to speak up. Because if women don't encourage men to speak up, guess what? They don't speak up because they're too afraid of the consequences. If men do something that women don't like, women give them hell for it. You get some tough guys. I know some tough guys. They're scared to death of their wives. You know, wives are Nazis. I mean, Yes, I mean, yesterday, you want me to work till midnight? Okay, seven days a week. Got no choice. Can't win. They say can't win, cannot win. These are tough guys that are like Marines, and and that have fought in wars. No chance with the women. No chance. This is a fact. So the women have to invite the men to speak up. If they don't do that, culture collapses. And so I've no one's ever invited me really to speak up. Very, very few. Okay, it's so rare that it's unbelievably rare. But occasionally, but it just doesn't happen. You go to social events, and it's like you feel like you're totally unwanted. Like your wisdom is completely unwanted there, totally unwanted. So I feel like I'm unwanted. I'll just leave. There's no, but no point. Why should I stick around if there's no invitation to speak? Invite some man to speak. Come on. And these social fuck. Good God. My, I said my. I just had an experience in my life where we were invited to a big function, and the man stood up. He unfortunately lost his wife, and he spoke for about 5 minutes or something, and then everyone oh. Clap, clap, clap. Everyone right back to blah, 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 EDD, blah, blah, blah. Ah, the women are all, just they're the center of attention, and their lives and everything's so important, their houses and decorating and everything. And the poor man, could hardly say anything. And I said, wait a minute. That's it? That's it? Yeah, that was it. At the reception, the pastor that gave the homily at the funeral, the service, actually ended up talking with me, and he had a better talk with me than anybody else. And he was shocked, said, "My God, you're the only person that has ever that even said anything to me about God or anything. You're the only person." Yeah, that's exactly the way it is in the world, folks. Exactly the way it's a complete catastrophe here. Okay, so expect anything to happen in this world. Last night I had a dream that was quite shocking. I'll tell you what it is. I don't know exactly how to interpret this, but I have my ideas. Is wow. I was looking at the sun. There was a sun in the sky, and I was looking at it, paying great attention to it. It was like the sun was going down. It seemed to be, I don't know if it was sun rising or sun setting. That's a good question, isn't it? It seemed to be the sun setting. It seemed I was watching the sun in the west. Okay, the way I watched the sun, it seemed to be that. And sun was going down, and then suddenly, instead of going down in the west, the sun setting, suddenly the sun started going due north in the sky like this. It was here that it went this direction. I said, "What the heck is going on? That is totally crazy." So I said, I followed the sun in the sky. I said, "Whoa, this is totally abnormal. What's going on?" And then the sun went quite a distance in this towards the north, and then it stopped. I said, "Okay, it stopped." But then I looked at the sun, and it looked very different. I said, "What's going on with the sun? There's all this red cloudiness right around the sun." I said, "That's really weird." So I got some binoculars, and I looked through the binoculars. Don't look at the sun through binoculars; it'll burn your eyeballs. I've done that a few times. It's pretty stupid. And I looked at the sun, and I could see that these clouds were not atmospheric clouds at all. These clouds are actually around the sun itself. Red clouds. The sun was had a constellation of red clouds moving around it. I said, "Uh-oh." I said, "That's not normal sun at all, is it?" And the sun wasn't that bright. I said, "How am I looking at the sun through binoculars, and it's not burning my eyes?" And I said, "This is and this." And then I woke up. I said, "This is really weird." Now, it didn't take me long, and I basically instantly said, "Wow, it was that Nibiru that I'm seeing," because Nibiru is said to have these sort of clouds and swirling around it of red dust. That's exactly what I saw through the binoculars. I said, this is not a normal sun. And they call Nibiru the second sun. So was this Nibiru, so was I seeing Nibiru? And was I seeing the planet shifting, you know, a tilting of the on the axis of the sun as that sun suddenly started going to the north like that through the sky? That's not its normal trajectory at all. Only thing that could cause that was the Earth tilting on its axis. That's the only thing that could cause that. Well, that's what I saw in the dream. And it's like, wow. Okay, wow. Whatever happens is what happens. But, you know, it didn't really, you know, cause me a downer in the day or anything. I said, okay, we're getting more and more used to, okay, the future may not be so great. That we're all expecting it to be a wonderful time, are we? Not so fast. Don't put your too many eggs in that basket. I think that's a bad bet. Very bad bet. The collapse of culture, every single way I test it so much, and it fails the test. It flunks the test completely, our culture. Now, it flunks. I mean, God bless the people on Facebook who pay attention to Ram Maharshi and Sri Sri Ananda Maima and the Nyingma Masters and Advaita, Punja Ji, and et cetera, right? God bless every one of them. Numerically, they're very, very small. I mean, the devotees of Sri Sri Ananda Maima numerically are so small, it just blows my mind. I mean, she should have, you know, millions of people. Facebook hits, a picture comes, there should be a million likes, you know, 100 or so, 50 likes, 100. I mean, this is total failure. Culture for globe. I mean, there's how many billion devices are there out there? You know, how many Android and Apple, iOS, whatever. I don't know, iOS, whatever it stands for. I don't know what that stands for. Doesn't matter. But there's probably billions of these devices in the world. And you're telling me only 50 to 100 likes of these super Dharma kings, you know, these Dharma kings. You're never going to get anyone better than that in this world. I'm telling you this for a fact. Dharma kings means that's as good as it gets. As good as it gets. Pretty much what it means. We've had Sri Sri Ananda Maima and Ram Maharshi. We're never going to get anything better than that in any realm that we transmigrate to. Never. And you mean there's like 100 people in this world with billions of devices that any one of them can access this? Okay, they have free access to the Facebook, right? And that's all it's getting? Are you kidding me? That's like total fail. Total fail. And even the devotees, I have to be honest, on Facebook, they don't have much juice. They really don't have. Some do. Some, I can tell the juice. Some have some juice. A lot of them are just like, wow, kind of like, let's keep it going, but they're just, you could just feel that they don't have the juice, you know? It's obvious. The world is just absolutely like pulled the rug out from underneath them, and they're just kind of like hoping, you know, hoping, but not adamant, not fiery and adamant and say, you know, I'm already there. In fact, I've always already been there. I have always already been there. And they don't have this brisk, intense progress that Sri Sri Ananda Maima said, you must have this, you must generate this, you must generate this momentum that grows and grows and grows and grows and grows. It's just not there at all. It's just not there. Yeah, it's not anywhere. I can't find it anywhere. Very few. It's very rare to come across this now. There's some here that are watching these videos that have this, that this brisk, intense momentum. You know, they have it. That is super rare. But that's what's required. That's what's needed. And then they have the flexibility. You know, they have the flexibility to be genuine and to be pragmatic, genuinely pragmatic. If the Holy Spirit says, dress down, go fringe consciously, you know, okay, go fringe consciously. Yeah, I won't be driving a Rolls Royce, you know, wearing all these guru gowns and, you know, all this accoutrement. You know, no, I mean, riding a skateboard in or something, walking with a skateboard. My other car is a skateboard. Skateboard and a t-shirt. Ragged but right is a great motto we should have. Lao Tzu, you know, left China, it was collapsed, ready to collapse. And believe it, you know, if you know history, look, these collapses are not pretty. They're nasty, very nasty. It may last thousand years, more than 1,000 years, who knows, you know, it once vanity wins the game, it's a terrible, terrible scene that happens. And of course, it's all up to the women. And women have to invite men to talk and say, we are going to go listen to this, and we are going to discipline ourselves, and we're going to support this, and that's just the way it is, and we're going to crush vanity. We're just going to crush it. Intelligently. We're going to back off of it intelligently. Yeah, if you try to crush it too fast, a backlash can happen. So basically say, we're going to dedicate the rest of our lives to absolutely abhorring vanity in our lives, and we're, you know, and that's all there is to it. It's the only way that culture can reconstitute itself. Because when the women aren't vain, the men realize this, and they automatically start saying, hey, you know, I've got a chance now. I've got a chance to escape transmigration. Wow. And they start being able to breathe again. And then they start getting into that, you know, the male practice mode. The discipline, males are, you know, can be tremendously determined and disciplined and become experts. Women, again, by nature, are experts at multitasking, but they're not good at being experts at one thing, because they're not good at all at that. Historically, this is just a fact, and it will continue to be a fact, just the way it is. That's the way nature is. That's the way everyone is, and it's, you know, inescapable fact. So women can continue to be experts at multitasking. Men continue to be experts at one area, focusing on one area really, really well. And we have to make the most of this and use both those abilities in the right way. But without women giving the true invitation and the true, you know, the true decision to abhor vanity for the rest of their lives, you won't hear from the men. You won't hear from the wise men. You won't hear from them. It will just be water and it poured into sand. And that's what's happened in the world. And you got a bunch of idiotic men running around just professing nothing at all. You know, just professing how silly they are, basically. And it's really tough to see that. You know, I hate seeing that. Because men could be, you know, professing truth instead of, you know, just juvenile silliness, actually. I'm waiting for my vehicle to get some tires. I'm reading these car magazines. You know, it's just like the obsession with machines and cars, and, you know, machines. Oh, you know. Yeah, how sad, how sad, how pathetic. Their expertise gets channeled into materialism. How sad is that? It's terribly sad. I got depressed. Got very depressed over that. Because they could be gurus instead. If they channel that drive and determination they have into spiritual truth, they would be gurus, you know? But they don't do it because they're not invited to do it. Culture doesn't invite them to do it. The women want to have their luxury and their vanity. All of the vanity that luxury affords. They go crazy for it. I mean, I can't use names. I want to direct to attention, but we're aware of a situation that just came up, and it's like really a bummer. The, you know, gold digger situation, the woman just taking advantage of the man severely for vanity. You know, she wants to live a life of luxury, and so she's willing to do whatever it takes to accomplish that, even though morally it's totally wrong. But in culture doesn't do a thing to stop it, you know, not a thing. Because what? There's so much out there. Cannot resist. A good person, good person can't resist. The temptation is too severe. You know, tempting women is the stupidest thing ever. You know, if you give them too much luxury and tempt them too much, they're going to fall. I mean, if I was a woman, I'd fall too, you know? Yeah. What's that? More raccoons coming or something? I don't know. Raccoons, a whole family of raccoons was coming down the path yesterday. I came out to exercise. A whole family of raccoons was trundling down the path, and they saw me. And, oh, they stopped, and they sized me up, and I sized them up. And I said, well, I got this exercise bar that I'm using. And whoo, whoo, you know, the raccoon said, this isn't your normal person. I'm going to back off here. And so they kind of clumsily sort of backed away, saying, it's not easy for us to back away. You know, it's clumsy for us, you know. We don't like having to do this. And they didn't like turning tail. Raccoons don't like backing down, do they? They really don't. But they did. And I said, thank you. And it was all good. They didn't get angry at me. I respect raccoons and wildlife and all this stuff. Yeah, it's fine. It's good. They were looking for garbage. They're scavengers. But if I was a woman, I would fail too, in this culture. You know, we've invited failure into our world, plain and simple. Too many temptations. Good Lord. It's just criminal what's happened in this world. Targeted women. You know, the subversives targeted women with materialism. They knew it would work. It always works. That's why religion has always preached austerity, austerity, austerity. Crush vanity, crush vanity, crush vanity. Don't allow this stuff to come into the world. Don't allow the means of production to come into the world, because it's going to destroy our progress, which it has done. So, you know, lesson learned, for at least in my case here. I guess it's a tough way to learn a lesson, isn't it? It certainly is. But sometimes when you learn it, real tough lesson, it doesn't leave you so easily. And skateboarding is like the opposite of vanity. Yeah, you might have a cool decal on your skateboard, but that's about it, right? I mean, it's good. The clothes are very basic. You know, the whole thing is just like a non-vain culture sort of thing. Scruffy, ragged, just a black hoodie, sweatshirt, you know. The clothes are just, you know, blah. I did get some cool t-shirts, you know, though. It's all well wear. But it's still, you know, it's just really basic stuff and blah. And it's not vanity. My other house is a hut, you know. My other house is a cave. My other car is a skateboard. Longchenpa was very, very austere in his life and preached austerity to everybody. Of course, so is Jesus Christ. So is Sri Sri Nandamayamasa. So is Rama Maharshi. So is Jamyan Khyentse Choki Lodo. So is Padmasambhava. And the other gurus, very austere. Very austere. Now, Rama Maharshi is just so extraordinary. We love him so much. You know, those of us who are aware of him, you know, we just have the utmost love for him. He showed us what it's all about. You know, he didn't hold anything back. I mean, nothing. He didn't hold anything back from us. He just gave us the full picture. We would cherish more visits from you, Ramana. That is the truth. In our dreams, you know, in appearancing and in every which way. He's hard to get used to because we just can't believe it. You know, is this for real? Yeah, he was for real. And putting together a slideshow, of course, is very helpful for me because I read the quotes and stuff. And every time I do some work for Ramana to help his legacy. I get more and more insight into what he's saying. And I say, oh, so that's what you're saying. Oh, yeah, of course, that's right. Oh, wow. Now I see what you're talking about. It gets clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer. It's still got a ways to go, but it's really clearing up. And he's still with us. He says the guru is never the form. So when the form vanishes, the guru's presence in your life doesn't vanish at all. Still there. So we got to say, Ramana, we love you so much, and all this materialism in the world has not changed that, is not going to change that one bit. It's just going to make it stronger, actually. This whole world is designed to discourage us away from what we are. It just gets so discouraged. We say, well, that's just a fantasy. It's to make us think that the true self, the self, our true identity is just a fantasy. That's what it's all designed for, actually. This whole modern culture is designed around that premise, is we can teach ourselves to believe that our true identity reality is actually just a fantasy, and that this fantasy of time, space, and process and form is actually reality. In other words, completely turn things upside down and backwards. And living here in the United States of America, I've got to tell you, this culture is just hideous. It's just hideous. It's not worth saving at all. It's not worth saving at all. Middle class is being destroyed. The greatness of America was the middle class. I'm a proud middle class. Proud to be from the middle class. I represent what the middle class can be and was supposed to be, actually. They avoid the excesses of both sides, and had the time and at least enough money, time, etc., to, if they want to really get after the truth. Okay, because they're not trying to be filthy rich. They're very religious. They don't try to accumulate too much. They're very generous. They give a lot to charity, and they should be very humble and very pious, at the same time very intelligent. Middle class is the greatest class there is, and it's being wiped out. It's being wiped out. All this illegal immigration is how it's being wiped out. This is by design. The rich people brought this into this country, allowed it to take place, so they could just get even more filthy rich and have slave labor here, which is what they have. And they use the middle class to organize these illegal immigrants, not really illegal immigrants, but illegal laborers, and to teach them, to train them, all this stuff. And so the middle class businesses have been, using them and training these laborers. So they're now skilled laborers, okay. And now what's happening is the rich people are now cutting out the businesses that employ these people and going directly to them and saying, hey, we have a job we want you to do, but we'll just pay you cash directly, and use it as a side job. Meanwhile, the employer of these people are still paying all the overhead, the paperwork, the insurance, everything that's required to have an employee. They're footing the bill and pressure of all that, and the rich people are just going bypassing the business and going to and hiring these people, the skilled laborers now, directly for cheap, real cheap. Vicious, vicious, vicious stuff. This is the model now. This is what the rich people are doing. I'm very much right in the middle of all that, and very aware of it. The rich people are simply terrible. What more can you say? They've lost their minds. Greed, greed has got a hold of them, and the ego is driving their lives. If the middle class can't make a living. When you do that, they can't make a living. They're slipping down into the poverty class now, and actually, the rich want to destroy the middle class. and doesn't even want them around. They want simply the wealthy and a slave class. That's it. That's it. Nothing more. Because if the middle class is around, the middle class could say, "Hey, wait a minute. Let's start a business here, and I can get you more money. Let's, unionize. Let's get this, and let's. I'll make sure the rich pay you more money because I'll employ you, and I'll go talk to them, and I'll contract for you, and you'll get better pay, and I'll get some, better lifestyle too, and we'll start balancing, getting things back the way it's supposed to be." So the wealthy don't want that. They don't want a middle class. They just want, the greedy, filthy, rich people and slaves. That's it. Middle class in Santa Clara Valley used to constitute about 60 plus percent of the people here. I think 64% or more than that, maybe is a really high percentage. It's down to like, I think about 5% now, middle class in Santa Clara County, 5%. That if that isn't destruction, I don't know what is. And even the illegals here, who have owned businesses or they got managed somehow to get citizenship or something, they have businesses now, actually. Okay, so now they're middle class. They're being cut out too. The rich are going around them too, and going directly to their laborers and saying, "Hey, I've got a job. I don't want to pay, the fee that your business will ask me to pay. So if you do this on the side, I'll pay you cash." And they hire them for like $12 an hour or something to do this hard work, but skillful. That this skilled labor they're getting, we're talking about skilled labor for like $12 an hour. And so these filthy rich people are the ones who squeeze you the most. They're the ones who squeeze you the most. The richer the people are, I found, the more they squeeze you, the more they try to screw you, the more they try to trick you, the more they try. It's unbelievable. It's the middle class people that pay you fairly. And don't, a lot of these rich people, you do the work for them, they just simply don't pay you. That's all. They say, "Well, I don't feel," especially the lawyers say, "I just don't feel like paying you." "Well, there's something wrong with the work?" No, I just don't feel like paying you. And if you want, you can sue me, but it'll cost you so much to sue me, and you probably won't win anyway. So I'm not going to pay you." Happens all the time now. Get stories from everywhere. Just people just get all the work, and they just, the rich people get all the work, and they just don't pay you. I mean, are these people crazy or what? Are they dangerous to society or what? Yes, they are. And if we think that it's political, there's some candidate in America that's going to solve this, we're crazy. Although Trump is certainly speaking up about stopping the illegals from coming, which is a step in the right direction, if it's possible. But it's probably too late for that. But it's at least some, but Clinton, are you kidding me? She just said, "No, everybody come in." That what does that benefit? It benefits the rich, and wipes out the middle class. Wipes out the middle class. It's extraordinary, what's happening. And I knew all about this 35 years ago. I said, "I know exactly what's going to happen," and it's happened just like I said it would. You don't think the rich are very shrewd, okay? That's why they're rich. They're very unprincipled, no conscience, very shrewd. And of course, they're going to go around your back and steal away your skilled employees and get them working on the side for cash. And they say, "Hey, look, your boss doesn't have much work for you, right?" "Yeah, well, I got work for you." "So would you rather be sitting at home not working, or would you rather work for me and make $12 an hour instead of no zero?" What's the poor? What's the laborers going to do? Of course, they're going to say yes. What can they do? Because so you have a breakdown of society going economically now. Very bad breakthrough, breakdown. It's not a breakthrough. It's a breakdown. It's a breakthrough for the rich. Yeah, and it now it's all about getting rich, isn't it? For everybody here, it's instead of, "Hey, let's be middle class. And let's level it out in the middle class, and let's spend some time studying religious truth and listening, hearing religious truth." The middle class are the ones who listen to religious truth. The rich people are busy getting rich. They don't have time for that. Someone just told me, I get a lot of stories. I mean, I'm dialed into the whole thing. He knows people. I mean, the people I know filthy rich people. And he has 30 cell phones, 30 different cell phones. Each cell phone is dedicated to a certain client or friend or a business partner or something or project. And so he has all these 30 cell phones laid out on his desk. And so each one he knows that that's what's calling, and it's dedicated to that particular. So he's constantly picking up these different cells. Can you hold, can I call you back on this? Okay. Yeah, so he's got like ventures just going everywhere, just money just pouring in. You know, this is his life. These are the lives of these people. It's just how much money can I make? That's their God. That's their God. And the whole culture now is just getting caught up in this frantic money race. I've got no time. I've spent my entire life just studying the gospel, the good news, the gospel of the gurus. I haven't made hardly a penny in my life. I never think about money. Never thought about money. I said, I've got to get this information. I got to get skilled in this information. That's all important. And they say, you know, thinking about money, it becomes obsessive. Yeah. So I just don't let myself think about it at all. I just pray to God that God somehow, you know, takes care of me so far. That's happened, but it hasn't been easy, you know. Not at all. Very stressful. So, you know, God bless the middle class who try to be honest and do things the right way, and we're trained that way. And the best of the world comes out of the middle class, and it's being destroyed. It's being destroyed. And vanity prevents it. I mean, you get vanity, and the women say, "I don't want to stay middle class. No, I want to be upper class." And then the whole family is oriented in that direction, and the religion goes out the drain, goes down the drain. What is it that you sacrifice when you're trying to become upper class? Religion is what you sacrifice. The actual time that you have to spend is what you sacrifice. Sure, you keep piety. You know, you might contribute a lot to the church, but you lose your success. You lose it. That's what goes. Now, you're probably still watching television, watching movies, some entertainment, but you throw out the tough work, the stuff that really takes time, which is genuine spiritual interest, really takes your time. Okay, I've spent all my time on it. Have to. You have to spend more and more time because it's really difficult, because it's really a challenge. It's like if you want to be a virtuoso, guess what? You might probably not gonna be rich because you're gonna be spending all your time practicing. If you want to be a spiritual virtuoso, you have to spend all your time at it. And so this is how it is. So if money becomes the god of a world, religion is what dies. Genuine spiritual wisdom is what dies. America's dead already. It's dead already. If Hillary Clinton's elected, then they're going to lower the casket in the ground and put the dirt on top of it, plain and simple. If Trump happens to win, they may prolong the eulogy, you know, for a while. Not going to actually lower the casket on the ground and say, "Well, you know, I want to say a few words here." And some people might actually be invited to speak up, you know, and give, you know, prolonged eulogy. But if Clinton's elected, in the ground as fast as possible, buried, tombstone, nice little tombstone will be put there, and that's the end of it. Maybe a crypt or some sort. Quick crypt, you know, quick crypt over the grave, and off we, you know, onto something else, onto, you know, materialistic paradise as quickly as possible here. That's the end of America. But America is dead. It's dead. It's dead as a doornail, actually. So is the rest of the world, pretty much so. The world is really very much dead, meaning they don't know how to get free of death anymore. They've lost it. I know how to be free of death. Jesus came to bring us eternal life. Okay, it's all mental. Okay, d death is just a belief. Okay, it's just a belief, actually. It's all in the mind entirely. It doesn't even happen, actually. If we think we die, nothing has ever died. It's transmigrated, morphed, sure, but that's all it is, and that's all in the mind too. So the awareness and wisdom to get free of this delusion of death, that's what's died in the world. So we've died into death. The world is a place now where we believe in death. Whereas religion frees you from the belief in death. What did Jesus say? That's exactly what he said. Come on. How could we lose sight of that? I never lost sight of it. I said, this is essential. I said, I'm not going to die, folks. I didn't come here to die. Why? Because there is no death. There is no death. And people thought, I'm crazy. You're crazy. Everybody dies. I said, I'm trying to say, no, nobody dies. No, nothing has ever died. Death is completely, completely impossible. Totally impossible. Everything's just light, and light doesn't die. It presents. It doesn't, never dies. Presentations change, but it's all just the light presenting, and the presentation can return like Jesus resurrected from the dead. It looks just a presentation. The body's just a presentation by the light. And you want the body to present itself as dead? Okay. Now just present it again as alive. That's all there is to it. There's no death. Jesus didn't overcome death. He showed us there is no death. There is no death. Lazarus, get up. Stop pretending to be dead. You don't fool me one bit. Oh, yeah, Lazarus. Okay, Jesus, all right. I'll get out of the tomb. It's just light. Jesus was not speaking to the person. He's speaking to the light, to spirit. We are the light. We are the living light. That's what we are. So I got a great exercise routine going now. I'm hitting the stuff the Holy Spirit wanted me to hit. I had a block there, and the Holy Spirit got my attention. Said, you need to go faster, stronger, faster. I said, what? I'm hitting stuff unbelievable, Holy Spirit. No. You're still avoiding something, aren't you? I said, yeah, you're right. Pilates ball and the core workouts and the balance workouts. And I'm avoiding that. Well, now I'm doing it. Now I'm doing it. And, the Holy Spirit got me into it in a beautiful way. So, and it's very important because the yoga girls are just hitting it really hard. The vanity girls, really. It's really, they're just hiding their vanity through yoga, through this Aristotle spirituality. They're trying to disguise the fact that they've fallen, into vanity and into wickedness, sin. They're trying to hide that fact. They're trying to have their cake and eat it too. Yeah, we've given our vanity free rein and no more discipline, and we won't let men speak up at all. We don't invite them. But look how nicely spiritual we are, like that. Having your cake and eat it too. And so, they're crushing it. I talked to a guy recently, and he said, yeah, the women, oh God, they go after the core, the workouts, like unbelievable. It's true. And so I said, man, I just can't do that. There's no way I can compete with that. The physiology, the way they're built, the lightness of them, the way they are. They could do core workouts like nobody's business. And the yoga stuff, it's just the flexibility they have. And it's ridiculous. It's different. I saw some picture of a yoga girl. It was crazy. She had bent over backwards with her face now touching the back of her legs. It was just like unbelievable. Because of the flexibility, the hip structure, the structures of the spine, is different. The whole pelvic structure and the flexibility and all this is different. They can do this stuff. They can hit core workouts tremendously. So I said, what's the point? The Holy Spirit said, no, you need to do it. So I'm doing it. Now I'm starting to realize why. Because we can be so intimidated. You see, materialism uses physicality to intimidate. And it's very intimidating. It's subtly intimidating. And those yoga girls are very intimidating. And they can get you feeling like you're a drone. Like, wow, I can't. And you start then idolizing them, and you start falling under their spell. And then you're afraid to be ragged, and you want to be elegant. And you get pulled into elegant failure, which is what they're all about. elegant failure. Yoga Girl is all about elegant failure. And again, I don't mean every woman that does yoga is a yoga girl. Obviously, I'm talking about those who have let vanity have free reign in their lives and have fallen under the spell of materialism. That's what who are trying to spiritualize their materialism. That's what I mean by yoga girl, trying to spiritualize your materialism, your materialistic attitude. And, you know, dominating men, severely dominating men, never inviting them to truly speak up. No. Only be figureheads to spokespersons to just say what the yoga girl wants to be said, instead of saying, you know, you say whatever the Holy Spirit tells you to say, and if I don't like it, that's my problem. You don't hear that from yoga girls, do you? Women used to say that. Yeah, I mean, the preacher says something. It hurts. Yeah, well, good. I needed to hear that. Thank you. Yeah, now, oh, I'm so brittle. It makes me feel uncomfortable. I'm going to sue you. You know, that's sexist. He said, you know, that's misogynist, blah, 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 blah. Because it bothers me. It makes me feel uncomfortable. That's the yoga girl thing. Women didn't used to be that way. No way. They thanked, you know, the ouch, that burn. Wow, that really hurt. But I needed that. It's like a spiritual workout. Sure, you feel the burn in a spiritual workout. You know, the pastor, the preacher, the priest, the rabbi, the guru would say, hey, you know, you women, you're being way too vain, you know, so you're falling under the spell of sin again, and so you need to discipline yourselves, and this, you got to do this and this, and you got to do this, you know, penance. This is what your penance has to be, otherwise you lose standing in this social standing. And, man, that burns, that hurts bad. But, you know, they did it. And then they felt great about themselves. Like, wow, that was really tough. That was a challenge, but I did it. I did my spiritual workout. That's what it's all about. So, I can't afford to be intimidated into elegant failure. And the yoga girls are very capable of intimidating everybody. Unless you, too, say, hey, yeah, I can do the Pilates workout, too. You know, guess what? You know, I can do the balance stuff, too. Guess what? I can do the yoga stuff too. Guess what? I may be ragged, but I'm right. You know, so a little raggedness is fine, but I'm not that ragged. You know, so you need some pushback, physical pushback. This is what the Holy Spirit has got into my attention, is how much the physical materialistic culture uses physical fitness and physics to intimidate and bully. Oh boy, do they use it. And it works. It really does. And if you get too far pushed down, you can become overly eccentric and the wheels come off. And you can't have that. So I'm getting more and more and more fit, more and more fit. And people, you know, they feel it. They feel it. They say, I can't push this guy around very easily, actually. They try, you know, and it's not working very much as well as it used to, but at all. Because I know, I say, hey, you know, you want to work out? Let's work out. Yeah, you want to go at it physically? Okay, let's go at it. And let's see. And, you know, well, yeah, maybe you're more fit than me, but you know what? Not very much. Not enough to bully me around. Not enough to intimidate me, right? And I say, if I keep working out, you know, I'll get there too pretty soon, right? So, it's been helpful. So I'm you know, doing this. I've invented some exercise equipment, like I told you, that's like super helpful. My God, that PVC, I'm learning ways to use it. It is awesome. It is awesomely helpful for stretching your core and strengthening your sides. The sides of your core are so important, not just the straight abs, but your sides. This is what the yoga girls, the Pilates girls, they work on the sides, okay? The sides of their body and their hips along that. This is what's key. This is what's key. And this PVC pipe workout that I do now, the way I'm able to swing it back and forth behind me almost, it tremendously tones my sides in the Pilates ball exercises I'm doing, like swimming. I put a Pilates ball in a tire, and I get on it, and then I act like I'm swimming or paddling a surfboard or something, and it keeps throwing me off balance side to side to side, and I'm using barbells in my hands to do this, and it's like hammering my sides. Super good workout. Super very great workout. To get that side core strength on your sides, and flexibility too. flexibility and strength as far as your sides go, and that you could still be humble and ragged and everything, but deep down you know that, you know, you're in really good shape too, and I'm not really tempted by that elegance. You see, if you secretly feel out of shape, then that elegance tempts you. You say, because I'm really, you feel like, wow, I'm really a failure. I feel such a failure compared to them. But they're offering me this elegance. Oh, I can hide my failure. If I go to that elegance, I'll hide my failure. And they're offering me this. Say, hey, I know you're really a failure, but if you, you know, get this, go, do what I tell you to do, I won't say anything about it. In fact, I think you're really cool because you're like elegant. You have an elegant failure. That's really, I like that too. I really like that. And then the people are just, you know, they're putty in the hands of the yoga girls. Putty. You fall for it. You can't help but fall for it. So I was at a crossroads a year ago, and I said, you know, I might as well just become a complete failure in terms of just go fall apart and call it a day. And you know, just turn into some, you know, was that Colonel Kurtz in, you know, in some jungle somewhere, you know, or was that, you know, that, what was that, Marlon Brando is some, what was that movie, Apocalypse Now, where he just, you know, he went that direction, you know. As I said, well, what else can you do? And the Holy Spirit said, well, you could get in shape. That works even better. And the Holy Spirit said, I respect what, you know, what you're saying, what you're doing, because that's you know, it's there's a level of pragmatism to it, and saying, look, you can't you just go turn into a fat blob and say, yeah, that's cool too, you know. But deep down, they're gonna get you. You know, the Holy Spirit said, I tell you, you know, they're gonna get you eventually. Or you're gonna go eccentric. They're gonna force you into a corner, eccentric corner. And then deep down, I realized, you're right. You're right, Holy Spirit. But I said, I'm so out of shape. It's ridiculous. It's going to take me a long time. You know, do we have the time? He says, well, if you start now, yeah. So, you know, I've starved myself for a year. I've worked out, you know, intensely for most, you know, most of the year, getting more and more and more intense. So I've done it. I've done it. And I'm, you know, I'm sticking with it and doing more and more. So the, you know, that's a better way to go at it. It's a better way. Sure, it required enormous discipline and dedication for a year, but you know, hey, it's like a challenge. It's like better than climbing Mount Everest. It's more difficult, to say the least. So when you do something like that, you guess what? You feel pretty good about yourself. And you can afford to be a little ragged, which is very important right now. See, in order to help others be ragged, you yourself have to be very confident. So you can say, I can afford to be a little ragged. In order to be fringe, you have to be really, really, really confident about yourself. Otherwise, you can't really be boosterish about being fringe. You know, you kind of be apologetic about it. You know, you'll be apologetic. No, if you're really confident, I've had so much success. You know, I can afford to be fringe. I can afford it because I'm not far away, not far from the mainstream at all. I mean, you know, I'm. This is the benefit. I can afford to be fringe. It's like, you know, I'm spiritually rich enough to be fringe, which is what really works. And I can't be intimidated or bullied into the mainstream. Not easily, you know. Theoretically, it's always, you know, a possibility there. Theoretically, if I keep my fitness up, keep everything up, makes it a lot more difficult to get bullied into it. Raggedness is hip, fringiness is hip. Yeah, but you're, you know, you're fat blah. That's why you're doing it. Ha ha ha. You're only doing it because you can't do something else. But I would say, hey, look. No, I'm a rock star. I could be doing what you're doing, you know, easily. I'm fit enough to do all that, but no, the fringe is what's really hip, okay? It's not because I can't do it. It's because I can do it. It's because I can do both, and I'm choosing this because this is better. That's why. I'm getting the best of it, you see? So if you're just a fat blob, Colonel Kurtz, in the jungle, they say, well, you're just doing that because you're an idiot and you're out of shape and you're undisciplined and you can't get what's really better. But if you really are, able to, like I can, then they can't really say that so easily, can they? The lie is exposed. It's easier to expose the lie. No, you're just a loser. That's why you're doing that. I said, really? Yeah, I don't really look like a loser, do I? And they kind of said, I say, if you call me a loser, what am I? I might become the king, and then really going to be in trouble, right? And that kind of pushes back at him, right? If you're the king, and you're saying, no, I'm just choosing not to be a hermit instead of the king, and then they say, well, no, it's because you're a loser, and then you say, oh yeah, really? Actually, I am a king. And if I decide to go back to being a king, in the mainstream, guess who I'm going to come after? You, for being so, nasty to me, right? So you better watch yourself. And that, holds him in line, keeps him in check a little bit. And people don't give me a hard time. Don't boss me around because they know that if I wanted to, I could be the king, and they'd be in big trouble. So they kind of, you gotta keep that level of intimidation there, or else they'll absolutely crush you here in the world. They absolutely will. And they're feeling so weak right now. They go to the yoga girls and say, "Hey, could you show us how to crush the king? We want to really be free of any possibility that we might have to repent and do some difficult work here." And that yoga girl's gonna have to go back to him and say, "Ah, well, we couldn't quite, you could crush him this time, but maybe later we'll do it." So they have some dissatisfied customers there. That's okay. You don't think those Dharma kings could be kings? You better believe they could be. You don't think Jesus could have been a king? Everybody knew he could. That's why they thought he'd be the Messiah, King David. Here's the ultimate King David. This needs to be, a thousand, 100 million times better than King David. And Jesus said, "Yeah, but I'm not going to do it. I got something better for you." But if they looked at him, they tried to play this, bully game on him. They backed off in a hurry because they said, "Uh-oh, I'm talking to the king here. This is a king of kings right here I'm talking to. I better watch myself." Maybe I can say to people, if people could be true, I say, listen, you better be careful who you're talking with. You might be talking to a king who decided to be a hermit, because that's higher than being a king. You want to lower me down? Well, if you lower me down, guess what I'm going to be? I'm going to be a king. And then you're going to have to pay the piper for that. So you might need to remind a few people of that fact, that you lower a true, genuine hermit, a spiritual hermit, you lower them down, and you not may not like what you get. If I was a king, believe me, I would crack the whip more than anybody could possibly realize. They'd be in way more trouble than they could possibly handle. That is for sure. So they better count their, blessings that I'm not a king or not a politician or a lawyer or something. They would rue the day that that ever happened. So it's a, blessing for them. Don't try to pull me down. So they get the message. They get the message. Even the yoga girls get the message. Even the yoga girls get the blues, Even the yoga girls get the message. They're not stupid after all. They're enjoying their little tea party right now. So they don't want to spoil it. So it's amazing. The Holy Spirit has helped me devise some training aids that just work beautifully. Because I didn't know. I said, Holy Spirit, I don't know how I train myself the right way. I don't seem to find any way to do it. Well, guess what? You're going to invent something that does it. Wow. That certainly worked that way. Just throwing yourself off balance is just great. To have to keep constantly regaining your balance, like if you put yourself on your back on a Pilates ball and just start moving around like a baby in a crib, trying to, you're just like being tossed and turned, like being like, like you're in a washing machine or something. And whoa, I'm falling this way. Whoa, I'm falling this way. Oh, I'm losing my balance. And you have to constantly regain your balance. Well, you talk about a strain on your body and your psyche and your mind. That's a severe strain. You practice that way. And it's a whole different ball game. You have a different mentality, actually, when you can handle the strain of that. Now, that's a tough workout. Mentally, it's very difficult to put yourself in a position of constantly losing balance. You automatically want to stop that. I said, no, I want to, let me sit down and be balanced. So you have to really mentally force yourself to go through this kind of workout of being on this unstable ball, intentionally throwing yourself off balance. It really requires tremendous determination to do this. But the dividends are enormous. I have a BOSU ball, BOSU, BOSU ball, and I'm doing that throws you off balance. And I'm able to, like, I was able to do squats on, like, I'm surfing, like, in a wave, like, and right inside the tube of a wave, squatted down, like I'm riding the surfboard on it, on the flat part of it. My God, what a workout that is. Oh, it's tremendous. I'm getting better at it already. Do squats on that, and then as you're doing squats, purposefully throw yourself off balance, like you're like on the ocean, and you're riding a wave, and you're hitting all the chop, and your board is like, giving you all this chatter, tremendous amount of chatter. Force the chatter on yourself as you're doing that, and this just, this just is a whole different ball game of fitness, actually, folks. I'm telling you, it really is. And I resisted. I said, oh gosh, that's difficult. Yeah. It's very humbling, actually, but you get make rapid progress at it. It's been like 3 days or something. I already been able to do squats on the BOSU ball, on the flat part of it with the rounded part on, on the bottom, and able to, move and my balance and everything. And already I'm getting it already. So it doesn't take that long. If you're already in pretty good shape, you can do it. And I highly advise this. The yoga girls are doing it anyway. You just don't want to be too far behind them. They're going to be better at it than you probably. Sure, that's okay. But if you're good enough, they cannot bully you. They're going to have to back off, to back down. This kind of the smirk, but they can't really bully you because you'll have the mentality. You'll have a certain mentality. says, "Yo, I can, I can be thrown every which way. All the chatter and stuff, I can handle it. It's not going to wipe me out. I can ride the big wave. Intense chatter. Your border's just vibrating like this. Yeah, piece of cake for me. I can ride that wave. And lucky for you that I can too, because you don't want to deal with me if you pull me down. You know, you jump the shark if you do that. So, yeah, good, everybody wins this way. Everybody wins in the long run. Everybody wins." You know, you don't want to get a tiger by the tail or a lion by the tail, right? So it's better, the lion is, roar there, and you're like, "Whoa, better back off," like the raccoons. You're like, "Better back off." That's better for everybody. It's better for everybody. Nice days here in California. As always, there's never a bad day here. I wonder if those who back east, I met someone who lives back east, they haven't been out here for a long time. They say, "Oh, I just love the weather back east. It's awesome. You know, just the cold winters are so good." You know what? They might just be trying to compensate, saying that, but to try to suppress the jealousy and envy, because they're out here and it's just so awesome. The weather's so awesome. And back in the back of their mind, say, "Oh my God, you know, this is so much better than the weather back east." But I can't admit it to myself because that's where I live and stuff. So I say, "Oh, I love the weather back east. Yeah, it's just great." No, it isn't. It's terrible. You go on. But the silver lining. You could put a silver lining to just about anything, right? Sure, you could. Hey, it's pretty cool to get nice T-shirts for $12. You know, these are actually pretty good T-shirts. I think it's like they're like, cheap. But that's a lot of. I don't know what their regular price is, but yeah, that's a bargain. I haven't bought T-shirts in a long time. So this is a big change. Big change for me. It's just, basically no style at all. It's just a T-shirt. Getting back to the way I used to be. Just a T-shirt. And just very, very fringy. Then I tried to get back in the mainstream. Now I realize the mainstream is, it's death. That's all it is. Now, you're not going to find you're not going to find women that are not, suffering from vanity in the world hardly anymore. Super rare. So you just have to put up with it as best you can. Those who are at least, have some limits in some way. And okay, but it's nothing like it used to be. That is for sure. And still, vanity still has a hold of them, but at least it may not be as bad as most, And so you just have to put up with it. Is all you can do. Nothing to applaud about, and be careful. I mean, like the best, you know, women of the younger generation, the best of today's crop, it would be like really bad in the past, actually. They'd be seen as very vain. They'd be very severe sinners in the past. The best of them. That's a fact. Absolutely. They would stick out like a sore thumb. And the women look at them and say, wow, you're really a hussy. You're really a vain hussy, you know, terrible. The best of the young women would be seen that way in the past. That's how far we've fallen. So, yeah, I'm, you know, just at least I'm a little bit grateful, like, wow, here's someone who's not, you know, is not too terrible. That's about it. That's about all you could say. That's really sad. And the men, they're just, you know, absolute drones. That I think the men are like virtually extinct, actually, at this point. You know, if you can't beat them, join them, that thing. Okay, a lot of men are just deciding to become effeminate, you know. So you can't beat them, I said, well, I gotta join, let me just be a woman. You know, that's a lot of what's going on in culture, actually, a lot. And men from previous incarnations bring that karma in. They say, ah, I can't stand up to women, so why don't I just join them? Let me see if I can become a woman or act like a woman or be effeminate or something. Yeah, that's what happens. That's what happens. If men can really stand up to women, they don't become that way. They really don't. They have a lot of self-control, a lot of discipline, you know, just become celibate, basically. You know, really. They say that's way better. Like, I want to focus in on my expertise, you know, they become very focused and no nonsense. They don't go chasing skirts, no. Absolutely not. That's a woman's game. That's a very effeminate thing. To be a womanizer is very effeminate, actually. Very bad. Very weak. Playing their game like that. So Bill Clinton's a very weak man. He's a very weak man. Very weak man. He hides it well, though. So is a 44, extremely weak man. Those who have, you know, are men, they see that. It's obvious to them. There's very few men left in the world, but it's obvious. They're so weak. They're so weak. They're so controlled by women. It's just unbelievable. They can't focus spiritually. You know, they can't. And of course, they say to all the rest of men, yeah, you can be like me. You know, really? How about let's not be like you? You got a great example of what not to be. You know, but we've already had 4, 8 years of Bill Clinton, a great example of what not to be. Why do we need, you know, 8 more? Really? You know, this is ridiculous. He gave us a great example of what not to be. And 44 has given us an even better example of what not to be. 43, you know, had a little something. He got it pounded out of him, though. You know, he had a little bit of Texas in him, where he's supposed to stand up a little bit, but he couldn't stand up to his mom or his wife, probably, right? Who can stand up to Barbara Bush? You know, not many, that's for sure. But you got to, right? Yeah, absolutely you do. Who could stand up to Nancy Reagan? Oh, you got to, right? They'd say, "This is where you get off. This is where you get out of the car, Nancy, you know. This is where I say my piece. This is where I say what I need to say. This is where you get out, you know, this is where you listen." Okay. But yeah, we got this weak men. Because the women are, you know, they're undisciplined. They're ambitious, they're vain. They're gripped in the grip of the ego. They want their luxury. And look at the middle classes, you know, okay, you got some luxury. I mean, say, okay, you got enough. The middle class says enough is enough. This is what the greatness of the middle class. They intentionally restrain themselves. Say, look, enough is enough. I've got a pair of shorts. I got a t-shirt. I got some nice shoes. Hey, that's enough. That's enough. I still buy, if I get good clothes, I buy it used. Off eBay, something used. And if I get something, I try to get it like clearance, and then on super sale and discount. I got something on super clearance, and then if you spend $100, they took $40 off. So I got a couple of new clothes. But you know, you say, look, enough is enough. You don't go for vanity. It's a sin. You try to be modest. You try to be middle class modest. This is a very, very righteous aim. We should be very proud of ourselves, middle class. Very proud. And I try to convey this to middle class, you know, but they're not listening anymore. You know, it's really sad. Very sad. They're kind of in a state of shock. Got hooked by the entertainment, but middle class is supposed to entertain themselves. You know, they're not supposed to go to Hollywood for the entertainment. Like me, I can play guitar, I can do music, I can sing, I can joke, I can be a very funny comedian to myself, I can, you know, be very humorous, and very witty, supposed to use wit to entertain. A lot of ways, we're supposed to be able to entertain ourselves in an intelligent, witty way, so we don't go for the schlock. You know, professional entertainment stuff that lowers us down into being, you know, slaves. Decadent, very decadent stuff. Supposed to avoid decadent entertainment. It's very important. But that's all that TV is decadent entertainment. So, you know, complete collapse of culture and society has already happened. But the real, you know, it's like the flood has happened. But you don't realize what's happened to your house. You're hoping, you know, maybe it's not so bad. Then you go in there and all the carpets start molding and your whole house turns into just a big mold factory. Then you realize, your house is finished. But for a while, you hold out hope. You know, you get a flood, like the flooding in Louisiana. And, you know, I don't know where to get all that water. Send it out to California. Gosh, please. When you flood real bad, you hope. You always hope. You hope. You hope. Maybe it's not as bad as I fear. Maybe. So we're just in this state. We're already flooded with decadence and wickedness, okay? The U.S. is totally flooded underwater. But we're hoping when the waters recede that it won't be so bad. Maybe, you know, maybe I could keep the house, you know, clean it up, and then the muck, and you go in, this is nothing but filled with muck, rotting muck. Everything is saturated and it's all starting to rot and mold. And you realize it's a total loss. Your house is a total loss. That's when, you know. But this takes a while, you know. I mean, when you have the skateboard just moved. When you have a disaster, guess what? It doesn't hit home for a while. You keep hoping. Maybe it's not so bad. And ultimately, at some point, you realize it's a total loss and you got to rebuild your house and start all over. It's like, wow. Then you go into shock. Then the pharmaceutical companies get a hold of you. So this is what's going to happen. The U.S. is already flooded with wickedness, okay? It's already happened. Totally underwater already. So what I'm concerned about is when you realize it's a total loss, this is when the trouble strikes. So we want to be able to help out with that. people say, what am I going to do? What can I do? We've lost our culture. It's easy to lose a house. It's terrible to lose a culture. We've lost our culture. It's gone. It's dead. And we got to start over again. It's a fact. It's a fact. So I'm just trying to help everyone realize, hey, you know what? I'll help you start over again. I'm capable of doing that. Dharma Kings will help us start over again. They're up for it. They got the juice for it. Believe me. They absolutely do. Yeah, we just make a new start. You know what? It's going to be better than ever. It's going to be better than ever. This time, we've got this severe lesson. You know, once we have that under our belt and look back and just say, wow, I can't mess around anymore. The progress has to be brisk. The momentum has to be there. You have to protect your momentum at all costs. At all costs. You cannot let a day go by. You cannot let anything get after your momentum. You got to hammer it every day. You got to be disciplined and you have to work at it. It's the only way. And this is what will be preached. You must get after it every day. No two ways about it. And, you know, you have to be intelligent about it and know right practice, which is full stop in the wow practice. You have to be wise about it. You have to get wise. This is the practice you have to use. It's the same practice that all the Dharma kings and gurus have advised, really. Ramana says, just be silent. You have to essentially simply be as we are and nothing more than that. Practice that. You know, you have to get after that silent practicing, that the wow practice of, and we've explained it, and we'll explain it very clearly as we go forward. It'll become very clear and very good instruction. And this is what works. This is what works. So it's time to, you know, one of these days, people are going to realize it's a total loss. Probably very soon, maybe in a couple months, when likely Hillary Clinton's elected president. A lot of smart, wise people realize it's a total loss. Cultures, you know, total write-off. Time to write it off. This is what will happen. It's dead. Nobody's crying about spilt milk. We just have to write off the culture, write off America. It's finished, and we got to start over somehow, plain and simple. Maybe in a different world, different realm. I don't know. We'll find out. But you know, hey, you'll be a pioneer. So I'm already preparing for that. I know some people think that Trump's still going to win. They're putting their hopes in that. I say, don't, you know, hope for the best, prepare for the worst. Hope for the best, prepare for the worst. So I'm preparing for the worst. That is for sure. The Holy Spirit said, look at this. I said, what's that? This yoga girl running down the street. She was running real fast. And the Holy Spirit said, you see that? I said, yeah. He says, coming real fast. Real fast. I said, wow. I mean, this yoga girl was running fast. She's an expert runner. We see her around town. It's like, got a couple of these runners that are like trying to be professional runners. I mean, they can run fast. The Holy Spirit showed me. It's going to come real fast upon you. Real fast. And some, you know, some will say, no, it's not dead. But it's dead. What they're going to do is says, yeah, but it's an elegant failure. We're going to give it a real elegant burial. Real graceful, elegant burial. Oh, that's so cool. And the others would say, look, we don't really care what kind of funeral you give it. We're too busy focusing on reconstituting, you know, resurrecting it from the dead. We're going to resurrect it from the dead and be better than ever. So you knock yourself out with an elegant funeral. We're not going to even participate in that at all. That's the dividing between the sheep and the goats that's going to happen very soon. Very soon. I'm not going to preside over some elegant funeral. I'm not going to give some elegant eulogy. No way. I'm busy resurrecting it from the dead. And it will be resurrected from the dead, and it'll be better than ever. But those who are giving it an elegant funeral are going to miss it. They're going to miss the resurrection. They're busy, you know, designing the crypt. The Cryptons, you know, are going to be elected in office. Bill and Hillary Crypton. And so we'll have a real nice crypt, you know, but we're not going to even pay any attention to the crypt. I don't care less. I went to Forest Lawn in Glendale, drove all through it, and guess what? Pfft. Thanks, but no thanks. No need to go there again. What a letdown that was. I thought it was something really elegant, you know. This is the, you know, elegant graveyard. Wow, really? Got no interest in elegant graveyards. Most beautiful graveyard in the world. Most famous in the world. Yeah, I got no interest in famous, elegant graveyards. That was a nice little trip. Thank God for the pastor. He said, you might want to drive around here. He had presided over. He was the main pastor for Forest Lawn for quite some time. You know, he said a lot of really interesting stuff. He said, before you leave here, you might want to drive around and take a look at it. It's the most famous graveyard in the world. And you know what? I took his advice. Nobody else did. I was the only one. And I did. I drove all through the Forest Lawn. And I just said, wow. What a joke. What a joke. So that pastor helped me out, helped us out, actually. He wants to help. He's a good man. And he made it clear to me that he even joked about you. He said, society, we're going down the tubes, folks. We're really going down the tubes. There's no question about it. What can I do? He said, what can I do? Everyone kind of laughed, you know. Yeah, basically said that. Make a joke about it, I guess. That's all we can do. But when I said to him, look, I said, keep walking with God. He looked at me in the eyes and said, wow, thank you so much. You know, this, you just don't hear that anymore. People have just given up. He's in the heart of it. I mean, he meets everybody. They've given up. He could tell I haven't given up yet. He was kind of shocked. So we're not going to attend any funeral. Okay, we're not attending any funeral. You know, it's been a vicious death here, and we're not interested in any funeral. We're going to resurrect this, resurrect everything that's great from the dead, and reconstitute it in better, even better format. That's what I'm part of. So I'm looking forward to that. That's going to be a great, great revival ultimately will come. But again, you got to get your mind off this funeral that, you know, next 8 year, you're going to have an 8 year funeral procession. You know, I mean, sorry, we're not paying any attention to that. I've paid no attention to the last 8 years, actually, of America. No attention. I know what's going on. You know, it's a, you know, a eulogy and pronounced dead. You know, okay, no interest. And now we're going to get the actual burial, you know, elegant burial. Sorry. Not going to pay attention to that either. We got Longchenpa in the house. Okay. That's what we got. We're going to be paying attention to Longchenpa in the house. And that's very reassuring. Just saying that. Just like. Poof, brings me to tears. I don't say it too much. It brings me to tears because. You got someone who, total capability, totally capable, totally informed, total world beater, total universe beater, you know, you got the champion, you got the victor in the house, flying the one who's flying all the victory banners, you know, all the medals. Everything's there. Just he's in the house, you know. It's just you can't lose. The whole universe collapses, you know. The whole all delusion is nothing. is real. They all bow. All the whole universe bows to Longchenpa and says, yeah, you're the king. I mean, we're nothing. Sees through the whole thing. Everything is already self-resolved as it is. Just as it is, this instant is already, it arises already resolved. This is guru vision. Longchenpa is guru vision. Longchenpa is guru vision. Everything arises already self-resolved. Even failure arises already self-resolved. Even delusion already arises as self-resolved. Even death arises as already arises as self-resolved. Everything that arises arises as already self-resolved, just as it is. So arising and subsiding are exactly the same in guru vision. There's never anything that appears that isn't already self-resolved in its own inherent spaciousness. Never anything. That's guru vision. That's Longchenpa. Longchenpa and guru vision are synonymous. So we got guru vision in the house, folks. We have guru vision in the house. Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, guru vision in the house. And that causes a tremendous wow. We don't have any funeral. We don't have any burial. We've got guru vision in the house. And you know, we're such little, poor little skateboarders that nobody's inviting us to the burial anyway. Oh yeah, those, we don't really want them at the burial anyway. Oh, thanks. You know, we don't want them. So there's no like, hey, you gotta come, you gotta come, come on. How come you're not coming? We want you there, you gotta be. Huh? No. So fringy, we don't even want them at the burial. Gee, thanks. I don't know what they're doing. Guru vision, I don't know what that is. You know, just kind of skateboarders. What do you expect from them? You know, they don't even show up on our radar. So we got guru vision. Okay, that's what we have. We have guru vision. That's what we have. We have guru vision. That's what we have. And we know what guru vision is. Guru vision experiences everything is already self-resolved. As it arises, even before it arises. Even all potential is already resolved. Self-resolved. Resolved from the first. And Longchenpa can really, really talk about guru vision like nobody's business. And that's music to our ears to hear the great spiritual poet Longchenpa talking about guru vision. Holy cow. That's what we have. Just breathe the air of hearing the exposition of guru vision. Just let this register. We have guru vision. Guru vision is in the house. Longchenpa is in the house. He is here, okay? He is present. He has made it known that he is here and present. And his full attention is on sharing guru vision with us. Okay, his full attention is on this situation right here in the world right now. He has made it known to me very clearly. He's 100% in, okay, to help us. He's in the house. Longchenpa is in the house. This is real. As Ramana said, the guru is never the body. When the body vanishes, the guru doesn't vanish. The contact doesn't vanish at all. And so Longchenpa is intensely aware of what's going on in the world. He's all in to help us. He's in the house. So that means Guru Vision is in the house, and it's not going to leave us. He promised he's not going to leave me. So Guru Vision is not going to leave me until I have Guru Vision. He has promised this. So that means Guru Vision is in the house for us, okay? It's making promises to us that Dongchenpa's all business, and his business is Guru Vision, okay? And that's it. So get your skateboard and get your skateboard close. I didn't get a beanie. I couldn't find one I wanted. Maybe I'll go back. I ran out of money. Seriously. I gotta find some skateboard beanie. I don't know. Maybe just a ball cap is enough. But if you really want to be skate, you gotta wear that beanie, right? I don't know why they wear those. I have no idea. Maybe it's like the cheapest look possible. I don't know. We love Tim Lincecum because he looked like a skateboarder. You know, when he was pitching, when he was winning Cy Young Awards for the Giants, he dressed like a skateboarder. He had his black beanie, he had his clothes. He was like totally, like, I'm totally fringe. You know, he looked exactly like a skateboarder. I think he must have been growing up a skateboarder. And he didn't change, you know. He's just like a little skateboarder, you know. I mean, here he is, best pitcher in the world. And he's just like this, could just be like, you know, some kid skating to the mall. That's how he presented himself. I mean, that was awesome. We loved Tim Lincecum in the Bay Area. And he never changed, you know. He'll still wear his beanie. He's at the World Series parade. He just looks like a skateboarder. Skateboard kid. It's like a skateboard kid. It's like my kid brother, you know. Yeah, he's into skateboard culture. He's just, you know, doesn't have any money. Didn't look like he has a penny, you know. It's like, wow. Wow, it's very cool. Man, you know, he's the king. Right now, he's like doing an impression, like he's not the king, but king's always the king. Once a king, always a king, you know. As far as pitching goes, he's the king. I always wanted to be a pitcher, you know, so I know a king when I see one. He's the king. Tim Lincecum, man, he's the king. You know, he's an artist. He brought it. I mean, he says, here we go. He said, you want a piece of me? Here we go. See what you can get. You think you're going to score on me? You think, okay, here we go. Let's go at it. Let's see what you can do. It's 90, it's 97, you know, with movement, or it's, you know, 80, 82 in the dirt with a changeup, you know. Which is it? You know, you know, here we go. And man, never back down from a challenge. Never back down. Never back down. He says, okay, you know, let's do this and see what happens. It's like a skateboard, you know. They don't back down. Say, here I got a trick, you know. I might fall, I might not. I'm not afraid to try. Right? The stuff they do is insane. Like, what are you doing? That's like, you're going to hurt yourself. I said, well, you know, maybe I will, maybe I won't. We'll find out. If I do, I'll get pick myself up and and try again. Tough. Tough. Skateboarders are very tough. I talked to a top-notch skateboarder before he's not anymore. He can't skate because he busted both ankles. And he knows like the top skateboarders in the world. And I said, what's the secret? He says, no fear of death, plain and simple. That's all it is. You can't have any fear at all. He says, if I die, I die. That's it. He says, that simple. I said, what's the secret to, like, you're the best in the world? He said, no fear of death. None. Just go for it. Well, here it's even better because we know that death doesn't exist. It's not no fear of death, it's that there is no death. That's even better. We're like spiritual skateboarders. We have no fear of death because it doesn't exist. And we can actually literally see this fact. Guru Vision sees this fact. We're not just thinking it, we see it. So we're not aiming for an elegant failure, which is thinking there's no death. We're going to see that there's no death. That's Guru Vision. And I've already seen, glimpsed it, and I see what Longchenpa is talking about. I say, I seen Guru Vision. I experienced it. I say, yeah, that's the truth. So our goal is Guru Vision, plain and simple here. Nothing else. That's it. Anything less would be very uncivilized. We may not be driving the new Aston Martin. It might come out in a couple years. How much does that cost? Like 2.3 million or something. But actually, it looks like kind of like a skateboard the way it's built. We may not be driving the Aston Martin, but we have a nice skateboard. For $150. And who's really cool? I mean, who's really cool? The one who has an elegant funeral or elegant failure or the one who has guru vision? That's the question, isn't it? I don't know. Longchenpa, he comes back. Is he gonna look like a? When we see him, is he gonna look like some awesome guru? Or is he gonna look like a skateboarder? Right? He'd probably just look like a, like Buddha looked like a just a middle-aged bourgeois man. He didn't look like some guru at all. People said, "What's the matter with you? What kind of teacher are you? Where's all the, guru shtick? You don't look like a guru at all." See, I don't need to. I am Guru Vision. That's what I am. Everything self-resolved from the first. All beginnings and endings the same in Guru Vision, intrinsic spaciousness. So it's guru vision or die. Or at least believe you could die. Because that's the alternative. If you don't have guru vision, you believe that you're going to die. You believe that death is even is possible. And so in your little dream, you have a dream death. Dream migration, transmigration, You believe there's some gap somewhere. No. Even all gaps are resolved from the beginning, already resolved from the beginning. That's right. All imagined gaps, you could say, but that gaps too are self-resolved from the very first. Yeah. They don't even have any time to be a gap. They're already resolved. Even before they're a gap, they're already self-resolved. They appear as self-resolvedness, inherent spaciousness resolved within itself. They appear that way from the very beginning in Guru Vision, from the start, and at the end, the same too. Same. Guru Vision is in the house. Praise God. It's just a pushing sense, pushing since day one, pushing since day one, yeah, and pushing this truth, pushing Guru Vision from day one here in the world, I've been pushing Guru Vision from day one in this world. That is true. So we're still pushing it, still pushing it, still pushing it, and now Guru Vision says, guess what? Yeah, I'm in the house now. I'm in the house. Here we go. And accepting this is a big wow. Guru Vision's the house. The virtuoso's in the house. You're going to hear some nice music. Really, I mean, you think listening to a virtuoso is easy? No, it isn't. You're scared out of your mind. You say, yeah, my mind is going to be blown. I'm going to be knocked out. You're shaking, you're trembling, shaking before a virtuoso comes. The virtuoso comes out on the stage. Yeah. There's the piano, just a grand piano sitting on the stage. Virtuoso walks out, bows. You know, people are plotting. They're saying, "Go easy on us. Go easy on us." Virtuoso says, "Ah, you might not be so lucky tonight. I'm feeling pretty good. I feel like I got the juice tonight." Virtuoso walks over to the piano, sits down, relaxes, and stretches, you know. Sits quietly for a while, doesn't do anything, and you're sitting in your seat, and you say, uh-oh, I think I'm in for it, you know. Then the virtuoso starts out, and you know, like, wow. That sounds different than what I'm used to. Wow. And just the whole piano is just like, you know, hey, piano says, hey, you know, the boss is here. I'm not the boss anymore. The virtuoso is the boss here. And you're like, oh, uh-oh. The piano says, I can't boss this virtuoso around at all. So that's a different story, isn't it? And so the virtuoso starts, you know, just blowing the doors off the place. And you're just sitting there like with your, you know, like your aviation goggles on, like the wind, you know, the wind is just hitting you so hard, like a hurricane. And when the virtuoso's finished, you just sit there in your chair and you just say, my God, I'll never forget this. This just blew my mind. I was just completely knocked out. I said, what was I thinking? If I'd have known this would happen, I might not even come. So, you know, so you consciously, you got to be very aware of this. You got to be very great shape to handle a virtuoso. You have to be in very fit spiritual shape and all around shape. And you got to understand, it's going to blow the doors off the joint, you know, no question about it. It'll never be the same. You say, so that's what it's like. Wow. Never be the same. You know what it's about. Now you know what it's about. But also you say, I survived it. Holy cow. I mean, I survived watching Tiger Woods play golf. Man, it wasn't easy. I said, I'll never be the same. I said, I can't play like that. Are you kidding me? I'm a long ways from playing like that. I mean, theoretically, I can, but I'm a long ways away from it. This is a whole different story, you know. This is something different. This is a virtuoso. Yeah, you don't see virtuosos very often. When you do, you better go see them. Don't miss a virtuoso. Changes your life. Because you find out who's really in charge. Spirit's really in charge. Guru Vision is in the house. Ah, yeah. So, we hit it pretty hard here. Yeah, it's past midnight. It's 12:30. What time I gotta get up tomorrow? My vehicle's got like an oil leak or something. I gotta check it out. That's not good. Gotta get that looked at. And I gotta do some driving. Yuck. Man. Yeah. Shoot. Don't have any cash. It's never easy, is it? I gotta check to see if there's tolls on the bridges and stuff. And oh my gosh. Holy cow. Well, I gotta be in a good mood tomorrow. That's for sure. gotta be really determined. It's tough driving anywhere in the Bay Area and extensive driving, et cetera, et cetera. That's no fun. No fun at all. Pretty much there at this point, the video. So you have to be very positively determined to get through these days, don't we? Really have to be very positively determined. Ask for the help. Guru Vision, help me. Inspire us all. Guru Vision, inspire us all to just keep on going. Because I'm telling you, if you don't have that inspiration, you start feeling very depressed right now. Very bad. I mean, if I slip hard. Can't slip, can't afford to slip. Longchenpa's in the house. Keep telling yourself this, it's a fact. This is a tremendous virtuoso's in the house. He'll give you all the virtuosity you can handle and more, that's for sure. So, Guru Vision, Mr. Guru Vision is in the house. Yeah. Guru Vision itself is in the house, and just keep repeating that. Keep telling yourself this because it's true. It's true. So keep focusing on this. This will keep our